It is a criticism that is constantly made of us that any time that we respond to or we seek to point out the deficiencies in proposals, we are accused inevitably of acting only in our self-interest. And of course, it would be less than human if people who were looking at the change in the legal profession didn't say, how is this going to affect me? But when we look at reform of this nature, when we make a public contribution to debate, and in particular when the Bar Council does so on behalf of the profession, there is only one guiding criterion which we apply, and that is what is in the public interest. And there are many proposals which are described as a form of liberalisation, which is sort of sounds like a good word. But in fact, liberalisation in this context is an unusual word, because we have a system whereby every barrister operates as a single, sole entity, competing with each other. Normally, liberalisation involves dismantling barriers, dismantling groups, and dismantling bodies that come together to try to restrict, in some shape or form, competition between people. It is unusual, at least, for regulatory intervention to occur in circumstances where you have single sole practitioners competing with each other. And that is one of the issues that we need to bear in mind. The other question that must be asked when we're looking at the question of reform of the profession is, what is the objective or the purported objective of the reforms? Is it in fact to promote competition? And if so, where is the deficiency? Is it in fact to reduce legal costs? And if so, how is it going to do that? How is the cost of regulatory structures, or how are the costs of regulatory structures going to be borne, and how will that impact on legal costs? These and many other issues are some of the issues that are going to be discussed today. And again, I want to thank our panelists for coming today and giving up their time voluntarily to assist us in this very important discussion. I'm going to introduce the first speaker, who is Baroness Ruth Deitch, who is the Chair of the Bar Standards Board in England and a member of the House of Lords Communications Committee. She has lectured in law in Oxford University for many years before being elected Principal of St Anne's College, and she's now Gresham Professor of Law. She has extensive experience of regulatory bodies, having served as Chairman of the Human Fertilisation and Embryology Authority. She's been a Governor of the BBC, and she was the first independent adjudicator for higher education and is an independent member of the House of Lords. Baroness Ruth Deitch.
Listening to your kind introduction reminds me that wherever there is trouble, wherever there is sorrow and lack of money, I am brought out to regulate it. Although I have to say that regulation is not always the answer, and there are grave problems. I'm very pleased to be here today because I know that we share a great deal in common, but there are some problems that we have and you don't, and vice versa. But I'm only too pleased to share with you the experience that we have in London of regulating the Bar of England and Wales. I've been in charge of the regulatory side for 5 years. The whole regulatory side only goes back a couple of years before that. So I can tell you what it's like from the beginning. And I will repeat what I said at lunch. Of all the things I've ever done, you heard the list, regulating the bar has been the most difficult for all sorts of reasons. I'm not saying it hasn't been the most enjoyable, but it's certainly been the most difficult. You too are about to undergo great regulatory change. I'm speaking to you in my capacity as Chair of the Bar Standards Board, which is the regulatory arm, not the Bar Council, which is represented here today by Maura McGowan. I don't represent the bar, I don't market for the bar, but I regulate the bar according to the Legal Services Act 2007 in the interests of consumers, the rule of law, and a strong, diverse, independent profession. I note that your bill, which isn't yet law, like our Act, has a list of 7 or 8 regulatory objectives in no particular order. And I warn you that that is a problem. We have that same list of objectives, and they don't always sit comfortably together. You have to choose one over the other, and that can be very contentious. You ought to have another look at that list of objectives and decide if there is a hierarchy to them. When all is said and done, I think that the public interest should come at the top of the list. I was asked to talk to you about the difficulties that we faced when the regulatory and the representative arms of the profession were split, and the Bar Standards Board was formed, and the challenge of changing the way the bar is regulated in a turbulent legal services market began. Because, as you know very well, the regulatory changes for us and for you have coincided with the recession and the biggest economic pressure and cuts on the bar that could not have been foreseen at the time. And it's a bit of a moot point, which is having more effect on the bar, regulation or economic factors. The entire legal profession in Britain is under attack because of cuts in legal aid and fees, increased self-representation by litigants in court, and pressure to rely on mediation, which seems not to be working very well. And as a side issue, but a rather sad one, I think the great strides that we've made in the legal profession by way of social mobility and diversity will be set back. We were getting on very well with that, but the economic pressures, I think, will make that very difficult. In essence, the good side of regulation is that because of the statute, we, the regulator, can give the bar an opportunity to change their working practices if that is what they want to do or need to do to survive. The Legal Services Act in England facilitates, but does not mandate, the relaxation of the structures of working that barristers have known for decades. New ways of working together in the future, MDPs and ABSs and so on, may be sought not for their own sake, but because they are inevitable under the Act and because of the economic pressure on the bar, not only from the recession, but because the Ministry of Justice controls the purse strings of legal aid for many of the most socially valuable members of the profession. The tail of legal aid cuts is wagging the dog of British justice. So, the way that barristers regulate themselves is about to change forever. The other major change in our Act is the introduction of new ownership structures, as you know, for legal firms and chambers. In particular, allowing non-lawyers to own and manage firms, known as alternative business structures. Sometimes we call it a one-stop shop. It was nicknamed Tesco Law. You'd go to the supermarket to go shopping, and there would be an all-purpose legal office there. In fact, it's the Co-op supermarket that's been the quickest to introduce legal services on the shelves of the store. But sadly, as you know, only this last month, the name of the Co-op has been dragged through the mud, and I'm sorry to say that even Co-op legal services have not a very good financial first year. So whether this is going to be a good thing or whether the brand has suffered irredeemably remains to be seen. We've also introduced a new portal for complaints about lawyers' poor service, the Legal Ombudsman, which has worked well, I have to say. Charges of professional misconduct are still reserved to the Bar Standards Board. But on the whole, since I have very little time, I can say that complaints, a new mechanism, is working pretty well. And from what I've said so far, you can tell that rather than having a simple form of regulation, which we were promised, the statute under which I'm operating adds to it. We have over-regulation, duplication of regulation, and competitive regulation, none of it cost-capped. But that is because, unlike your bill, we have another layer of regulation. On top of me, above the Bar Standards Board, is the Legal Services Board, which regulates both the solicitors and the barristers and other smaller branches of the profession. They are the overarching regulator. Underneath them, there is my board regulating the barristers. And that duplication, I think, is not intended here. It has made regulation in Britain expensive and complicated. Now, it's not all bad news, far from it. What are the benefits of regulation? Well, splitting regulation and representation has given us an opportunity to challenge the Bar Council to modernise the bar in a way that benefits the consumer as well as the barrister. We will be able, although it's a slow process, to change the way barristers deliver services, giving them greater flexibility, if they want it, to develop their businesses as they want or need to, without compelling anything. The Bar Standards Board was established even prior to the Legal Services Act of 2007 to regulate in the public interest. And it is the public interest that still drives us, thinking about the legal consumer as part of that, but not the whole of it. Having lay membership on our board ensures that the legal consumer is very much at the front of our thinking. Consumer is a difficult word. For the bar, the consumer is not just the client who needs representation. The services of the bar extend to the government, to corporations, to foreign governments, to judges and to solicitors. And one must not be misled by the frequent use of the word consumer to think that the bar's main duty is to serve and do anything that the client, the immediate client, wants. I need hardly tell this audience, it's much broader and more complex than that. Nevertheless, having lay membership on our board gives us strength in having a variety of experience and perspective around the board table when discussing the issues. The quality of membership is crucial, absolutely crucial. Whether it's the minister appointing your members, which I hope is not the case, or whether it's you choosing them, the quality is crucial because the work is important, intellectually demanding, and long-lasting. Lay membership also gives us a commercial sensibility in our policy making and helps us design schemes that fit budgets and understand value for money. We strive, we hope, that we equip the bar better to survive the current turbulent market. Also, having lay membership reassures the public that the bar is not acting solely in its own interests. There is no getting away from it now. Every great profession is having to have separate regulation, separate from representation, and that regulation is having to include lay members in order to reassure the public. That is the way of the world. There is no getting away from it. Our appointments to the board, both barristers and lay members, are carried out by an independent appointments panel with a lay chairman, he happens to be a doctor, in the chair. In contrast, I think, to your new regulatory authority. I hope very much, and I don't know the politics or the details of it, that you can have an independent appointments panel making appointments to your regulatory authority. As I said, I think that's very important for perception and also because you must get the best people available, not just representatives of different interests, legal and non-legal, but really top people doing this important job. The difficulties in regulation. Well, many at the bar resisted change, and some barristers now, I think, even now, confuse the role of the Bar Council and the Bar Standards Board. Achieving independence of regulation within a profession that has been self-regulating for centuries has not been an easy adjustment for many members of the profession. And lay members can be seen as having ideological baggage. It can be a suspicion that they are carrying out the will of the government. And the will of the government is, of course, here and in England, to cut expenditure. So you've got to be careful there. The barristers may see change as an attack on their professional standards. They have to appreciate that transparency is key to the public interest. We have to ask difficult questions of the profession about maintaining their quality of service and continuing professional development. I think a mistake we've made is not investing enough time explaining our regulatory role. The bar needs to understand, and perhaps we didn't make it plain enough, that the Bar Standards Board supports a healthy and independent bar, because it is key to the rule of law, the proper administration of justice, and benefit to the public. Also, we have the difficulty that you will not be under. We have an overarching regulator above us, rather like the Care Quality Commission in England and the Financial Services Authority, a large overarching regulator, which was determined and still is determined to push their own timetable on us. Under the statute, their job is to assist us, but they have interpreted that as push us and direct us. I see that you have the word ensure in your bill. The authority will ensure, which I suppose is very much along the same lines that, in fact, our Legal Services Board has taken. We've been pressured to move quickly and liberalise the market, but we have also been concerned for years that the risks to the consumer from some of the major changes afoot, they must be fully considered, tested and costed. And I'm sure you will understand that. Our approach has been cautious, perhaps fairly slow, but we do not fear change. We've resisted short-term cosmetic measures. We're trying to deliver, as regulators, long-term fundamental change, which has been thoroughly consulted on, tried and tested. For example, our new handbook or code of conduct, which I think will go down well, which comes into force in January, has been some years in the making. The new bar professional training course, again, thoroughly tested and piloted. Continuing professional development, about to change fundamentally, has been years under discussion, but we think it's worth it in order to familiarise people with the changes. So we have to push back against certain forces that want us to move more quickly than we think is sensible. Unfortunately, making changes inevitably leads to increased cost. The practising certificate fee paid by the bar began to creep up, not just because of the regulator's activity, but that was a contributing factor. It has coincided with the recession, and the effects of the increased practising certificate fee, especially on the younger and newer end of the bar, has been keenly felt by many. Knowing that I was coming here, I've been checking to try and get the latest estimate of how much the Bar Standards Board costs the profession. I'm told, and there are all sorts of ways of slicing that particular cake, that it's about £500 per head. Maura may embroider that and tell you more fully, but let us not get away from it. It is a lot of money. I apologise, it's not our fault. There are things we have to do because of the Legal Services Board and the statute, the requirements of IT, and so on. But let there be no doubt about it, it is expensive, and we probably account for, what, about half the PCF, at least half the PCF. And I feel bad about it, but it is inevitable. We don't do anything that's not inevitable and necessary. Some examples of things we've done. Well, alternative business structures, which will be upon you too. The Legal Services Board, which is the regulator above us, envisaged vast organisations of a multidisciplinary nature in the belief that this would help bring down costs for the consumer. Well, first of all, we haven't got there yet. We're still crafting it. We're keen to ensure that any new structures do not risk diluting the culture of personal responsibility amongst barristers. We are also worried that in smaller legal centres outside of London, if all the specialists in one particular field, let's say divorce, are all gathered together in one alternative business structure, they will in fact be conflicted out when it comes to acting on either side of one particular piece of litigation, whereas that is not the case at the moment in chambers. Large organisations do not necessarily bring down costs for consumers. We know that chambers' overheads are less than those of solicitors' firms. What the overheads will be in ABS's remains to be seen. I am guessing that they will be nearer the solicitor end rather than the chambers' end. There is also a danger that in a large organisation, the moral and personal responsibility of its members is diluted. And fairly recent evidence for this can be seen in the roots of the banking crisis, which remain with us even today. Big doesn't always mean better. And we found that there was a risk of lower prices in alternative business structures for clients, but possibly less choice and quality, more phoning in with a mechanized answer service rather than seeing a lawyer face to face. That may be all right for certain situations, but not all the time. We question whether the large multidisciplinary law firms would create Tesco Law. What happens if that drives the small high street corner shop lawyer out of existence? And that is happening already. Will big entities, ABSs, dictate rules to consumers and suppliers because of their might? However, in protecting the consumer, we do not wish to shackle barristers to the chamber system, which might leave them ill-prepared to compete with solicitors and other legal professionals. But it will be up to them. We will get alternative business structures ready for regulation in a year or so. But of course, it's not compulsory. It will be a question of choice for lawyers. We have altered the rules to permit barristers to become managers of legal disciplinary practices with solicitor partners. So we are halfway there. They can be shareholders. There are new ways of working. Barristers can now work in dual capacity. A young barrister might work part of the week for an organisation or the Crown Prosecution Service, and the rest of time for his or her own self. We're more relaxed about rules in relation to sharing premises, and we've allowed direct access. Barristers can now, on the whole, have direct access from members of the public and conduct litigation, and we hope that that will help them. We're still keen to preserve individual responsibility. Our new handbook is carefully balancing individual responsibility with the freedom to start acting within entities. Compliance, no doubt, will be expensive, and from January, there will be a new duty to report by oneself or others serious misconduct to the Bar Standards Board. The new handbook is based on core duties and guidance. It got slowed down because the Legal Services Board above me kept insisting on outcomes-focused regulation. I haven't got time today to give you my opinion of outcomes-focused regulation, but perhaps you can guess from the twitch of my shoulder what I think about it. So there is permission for barristers to work in new ways with more flexibility, but we're very keen to keep the clear blue line between the bar and solicitors. Our regime will be different from theirs. We will provide a niche regime for advocates. Fusion of the two professions is not on our agenda, though I see that in your bill there is preparation for certainly a paper on that very issue. I haven't got time to tell you about the other things that we've done. We're moving to a risk-based approach. We're about to change continuing professional development so it is an easier regime in terms of paperwork, so that it won't just be a question of doing 12 hours at any cost, but it will be more introspective and more tailored to what the bar wants. And we will be checking up on people by spot checks rather than ticking everybody off in their boxes year by year. The market in which you're working is changing around you. Even if it wasn't for regulatory and legal change, you and we would have to change anyway because of government imperatives and the recession. You have the opportunity in the bill to strengthen the Irish bar for the benefit of barristers and also, more importantly, for society as a whole. We've had separate regulation and representation for almost 8 years, and yet it is only the start of a journey. We continue to seek evidence. We don't have very much so far about how alternative business structures will work. We have to continue to monitor the impact of all these new changes on women, black and ethnic minority barristers, and poor students who want to come to the bar. Social mobility is very important to us. There may be risks that damage the public interest and hinder the much trumpeted benefits to consumers that competition and liberalisation may bring. Competition and consumerism are by no means undiluted benefits, and they don't always work, for example, in health and education. People want affordable and accessible law, and there's a limit to what the regulator can do by way of that because of the outside forces exercised by the government. But we're very keenly aware of that. We will take a gradualist approach to reform. We will constantly be seeking for evidence, and we will try to avoid jargon. And I just want to take 1 minute to say what struck me when I read your bill. It's true I don't have your latest amendments, but I read a bill that ran, I think, to 110 pages, and I just spotted a couple of things that worried me slightly. I think you want to make sure you get the definition of lay and barrister right. This is a personal thing with me because I did do the bar exams. Everybody did it when I was young, but I've never practiced at the bar. I never did pupillage, and yet I am defined as a barrister because I did the exam. And I think that's a shame because someone like me actually makes a useful lay member, having read law, knowing about it, and yet having no financial interest now or ever in the bar. And I hope you can get that definition right so that you can use people like me who've studied law but never practiced. Because believe me, knowing something, indeed knowing a lot about the law, is absolutely crucial to being able to regulate such a very complex and sensitive subject. It struck me also that there's an awful lot of government interference in your regulation. This may have changed, but on a quick reading, I could see that the government was appointing and could remove a member of your authority. I was quite shocked to see that the minister has to approve the strategic plan, that the minister appoints the chief executive and the staff, that the strategic plan has to be submitted to the minister and the code of conduct for approval, that the members of the Complaints Committee have to be approved by the Minister. The Disciplinary Tribunal is appointed by the government. The Minister determines the level of costs. That does not strike me as independence. I hope you're going to tell me that amendments have got rid of all of that. I warned you about the list of objectives which come in no particular order and really need a hierarchy. I can see that Section 30, Clause 30, promotes fusion and a new profession of conveyancer. You have a lot about costs. We don't need that because we have something called Barco, which Maura may tell you about. And finally, I think complaints in our new structure have worked well. The legal ombudsman has made a great success of his job. They have a lay majority. We don't actually. The complaints that we deal with within the Bar Standards Board don't have a lay majority, but there's a multi-layered system and it goes to a disciplinary tribunal in the end. We only deal with professional misconduct. The poor service goes to the outside legal ombudsman. So I hope you're not feeling more gloomy than you were half an hour ago. As I said, regulation with lay participation is inevitable. And if you are so minded, you can use it to benefit consumers and ensure the future of the bar, which I very much hope you will do. Because if there's one thing that motivates me in this most difficult of jobs, it is a passionate belief in the tremendous quality and good of the English bar and the Irish bar, renowned all over the world, essential as brilliant advocates to the upholding of the rule of law, the ability to challenge the government, more important today than ever it was. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Baroness Deitch. A striking and perhaps depressing feature of what Baroness Deitch had to say to us is the contrast between the level of regulation in the United Kingdom, or in England and Wales, I should say, and that proposed in the bill. And I just referred to two particular aspects in particular, both of which Baroness Dietsch touched upon. One is the question of the cost of regulation. The new legal authority will be responsible for regulating barristers and solicitors and any alternative business structures that may be proposed, including presumably partnerships between barristers and solicitors, partnership between solicitors and estate agents or other professions, all of which will incur very significant costs. In contrast to the current cost we have of our disciplinary structures, which have a lay majority, which operate on a shoestring budget, and about which almost nobody makes any complaint, and one therefore has to question whether or not the costs that will ultimately be borne by the consumers of a super regulatory structure are worth it and justify whatever is supposed to be the objective of such regulation. And the second point that occurs to me is what Baroness Dietsch had to say about the necessary independence of the new legal authority, in particular both in terms of the appointments to be made. There have been some amendments proposed to the appointment system to which she was referring, but in addition, the extent of the first-line control exercised by the Minister over the Code of Conduct. It's not merely a question of a veto over proposals to the Code of Conduct which might be put forward by the authority, but in fact the Minister can himself put forward proposals for change which then have to be adopted as part of the Code of Conduct. That is a form of first-line regulation of a legal profession by a government and by a minister, which is, so far as I know, unprecedented in any Western democracy, and certainly does represent, in my view, a serious threat to the independence of lawyers generally. So those are matters that will have to be seriously considered in the bill. The next speaker is Professor George Yarrow. Professor George Yarrow is chair of the Regulatory Policy Institute and an emeritus fellow of Hertford College in Oxford University. He's a former member of the Great Britain Gas and Electricity Markets Authority and has served twice on the Republic of Ireland's Aviation Appeals Panel. In 2012, he chaired a review for the Australian Commonwealth Government on appeals processes for regulatory decisions concerning energy networks. Over the past number of years, he has, with other colleagues, written reports for the Legal Services Board on the economic rationale for legal services regulation and on barriers to entry, exit and structural change in the market for the solicitor services in England and Wales, and he's co-authored a recent report for the CCBE, the Council of the Bars and Law Societies of Europe, on the contribution of law services to the European economy, which was summarised in a presentation to the International Bar Council's Leaders Conference in Zurich earlier this year. And he's going to talk in particular on the impact of economic analysis on the legal profession and on alternative business structures. Professor George Yarrow.
Thank you. I'm going to visit PowerPoint on you, I'm afraid. I actually hate presentation slides, but I was thinking about this simultaneously with a speech I had to make last Thursday in London on climate change regulation. And that had to be presentation slides. And it's quite useful to actually toggle between two quite different subjects when you run out of steam on one. So I hope the slides are clean and you don't see something suddenly appearing which has more to do with that other lecture. There aren't very many of them. As has been said, this is based upon a sequence of now three reports. The third of those is not yet published, and all of them in different ways are slightly controversial. So don't think of this as reporting back any sort of economic consensus on these matters. Let me start by saying that I think it's fairly easy to see the reasons for the current political interest in legal services regulation. A few years ago, and rather late in the day, the World Bank woke up to the fact that if you look across the globe, then economic performance tends to be rather well correlated with stable and well-functioning legal systems, and developed a program of promoting the rule of law as part of an economic development strategy. So that brought law very much into the sort of view of economic policy. From there, it's a next step. A next step is fairly easy. if that is the case, then the performance of lawyers themselves in their going about their own business is going to be important for economic performance, and therefore you get a switch of attention to the behaviour of lawyers themselves. It's a two-way influence, of course. So the good news in all of this is, although you've got more attention being placed on your conduct by politicians and by economic policymakers, economic liberalisation generally has been very good for the demand for lawyers, at least on the commercial side. None of this, of course, applies to the criminal law. The traditional approach, as Ruth Deitch has said, for centuries has been one of self-regulation. And it is the case that there is, as yet, no other standard model for legal services regulation. In economic terms, self-regulation is motivated by a desire to protect a collective reputation which can be potentially damaged by individual members of the profession if they don't perform. The economic analysis of that would be that such reputational damage is potentially harmful to demand for the relevant legal services. Don't want to miss anything out. And that would explain why it is that we see self-regulation being developed essentially as a market expanding. Ah, right, okay, that's it. All we need is a bit of knowledge. Self-regulation is there to expand the market and not to contract it, not to restrict the market. But there are some caveats to that, and here is where the problems, I think, start. Self-regulation, effectively, in terms of what we would call institutional economics, means establishing rule books for the profession. And whenever you've got a rule book, definitionally, you're dealing with something which in some way or another is restrictive. It is designed to be restrictive of human conduct. Now, there are certain schools of economic thought which see more or less any restrictions as being restrictions of competition or as restrictions of markets. So there is actually an intellectual error, an intellectual virus, if you like, that is in the system, which sees a rule book and sees restrictions and immediately interprets that as restrictions of competition or restriction of markets. It is, as I say, a mistake. It has never been part of the classical liberal tradition in economics, which of course sees rule books, the rule of law, as essential foundations of market economies. But you will find it, and you will find it particularly in certain parts and certain members of the certain practitioners of European competition law. There is a particular sort of subset of German liberalism which holds some of these views quite tenaciously, that if you've got a restriction in a contract or an agreement, that restriction, you can more or less look at it, look at the form of it, and say immediately that is a restriction of the market, it's a restriction of competition, and that immediately creates a tension, of course, with the competition articles of the treaty. Here, I think economists mostly, not all of them, some of them have succumbed to that particular line of argumentation, but mostly economists are helpful in that the focus of economics tends to be on the effects of rules of conduct and not on their form. So economists don't naturally sort of look at a document and say, what does this mean? They look and then they say, well, what are the effects of this? What's happening in the market? And that's a much more sensible question to ask about a rule book than to try and guess what its effects will be just by looking at it in abstract. The difficulty then is that self-regulation potentially gives the profession a substantial degree of control over rule books, and that control is a form of market power. If you control the rule book of a market or of a particular group in a market, that gives you market influence. And in many circumstances, it is, of course, the case, and that's why it's been developed, that it's in the interest of the profession to use that control in ways that are market expanding. I've said that already. But not in all circumstances. So there may be situations where control of rule books can be used, for example, to suppress new sources of competition to established ways of doing things. Now, that's an argument I think that it's very difficult to resist, because it's an argument that goes right back to Adam Smith and The Wealth of Nations. And there's an old saying in economics, which was introduced by Professor George Stigler, Nobel laureate from the University of Chicago, who, on giving advice to young economists, said, "You should never worry about disagreeing with another economist unless it happens the other economist is Adam Smith, in which case you should think again." So it's a fairly authoritative view, and one that shouldn't be dismissed. So what to do about that? Well, the interpretation that I and colleagues have given to the way in which regulation has developed in England and Wales, not very well organized here, is that essentially that's the purpose of oversight regulation. It's regulation of the regulators, or more strictly, that the role of the Legal Services Board should be, properly interpreted, a concern about whether the profession is a self-regulating profession, which establishes its own rule books, might at certain points be using that power, that control, at the expense of, say, the client or the consumer of legal services. And I agree, that's not the only consideration, any of the other considerations in the objectives might come in here. I should say, it's quite interesting that we, of course, were asked to produce the report and the paper, which was entitled Understanding the Economic Rationale for Legal Services Regulation, after the event. So the regulation had been introduced, the new system had been introduced, and then it was a question of the regulator saying, "What is our purpose?" Which is a rather strange way of doing it. And it was quite interesting at that early stage that the tender for the work clearly contemplated a rationale for legal services regulation which was rather similar to financial services regulation. So the tender document itself made reference to a similar foundation document which was written for the Financial Services Authority in London at the time it was founded, which was called the Rationale for Financial Services Regulation. And that was cast in terms of a very familiar set of economics to do with market failure. And you probably encountered this somewhere or another, some of you. Which goes around seeing failures in markets and then says that regulators are there to correct the failures of markets. We, in fact, said that was a very bad way of looking at things and suggested an alternative, and were very, very surprised indeed to win the contract. But at least it showed some openness to thinking about what it was that an oversight regulator should be doing. But the point of all of that is that there was no great plan here, no very clear sense of what the regulatory structure should be. This is a sort of learning process, including by the regulator itself, or the oversight regulator itself. And so I stress that this new approach was then, and that was 2010, and still is now, experimental in a simple and direct sense of that word. Well, where have we got to? ABSs are obviously allowed and are now registered and are active in the solicitors market. And it's interesting to see what's developed in the solicitors market. We've got the Legal Services Board, which is the oversight regulator. Then there is the Solicitors Regulation Authority, which is the regulator of solicitors. And what you observe, as a matter of empirics, is that to address the concerns that were raised by these alternative business structures, the SRA has taken a very close interest, not just in things like professional conduct and the behavior of the profession, but actually in the business models, the business governance, and the financial structures and so on of the entities, of the firms themselves. And that's all firms, so that's from the big commercial London solicitors right through to the sole practitioner in a specialist area or in a very small general practitioner high street practice. So we have the development of entity regulation, regulation of the business structures, as well as regulation of the profession as it's traditionally been conducted. Now, you can see why that might happen, because if you tell a regulator there is a problem, regulators say, okay, we'll regulate. Give us some more resources and we'll do a bit more. So that if you believe that ABSs are a very big problem, what you do is say to regulators, this is a very big opportunity for you to regulate more, because there's a big problem, so we need more regulation. That's the way they will look at it. And the other aspect of it is that the people will say, well, you know, you can't just regulate ABSs. We have to have a level playing field, because otherwise you're tilting the whole system against ABSs and you're stopping the experiment, which is to see how they will do in terms of delivering services to end clients and consumers. So there comes an argument, let's have a level playing field. And what that has led to is entity regulation right across the board, so that the same entity regulation is applied to a sole practitioner, two-partner firm, three-partner firm, four-partner firm, as would be applied to large solicitors or to ABSs. Now, if you stand back for a moment and look at that in comparison with other markets, it is really quite an extraordinary state of affairs. I mean, it is not normal in our economies to actually have a regulator who's interested in the financial structure, the governance, the business plans, the business models of small businesses with one, two, three people operating in them. So it's got to quite an extraordinary position, but that follows a certain regulatory logic, a little bit like politicians' logic. It's not normal logic, but you can see the track of the logic. There's a problem. We have to deal with it. We have to deal with it in an even-handed way. Of course, the regulator, it's more resources all the time for the regulator, so the regulator keeps growing. And what you get is where I think we are at the moment, and what I would argue is developed in England and Wales, and that is a disproportionate level of regulation, very roughly sledgehammers to crack nuts, to what might be a relatively minor set of problems. Now, I think the key advice I would give to you is this depends on what you think of ABSs. If you really think they are big bad wolves, and you say so and keep shouting, the wolf is at the door, remember that's an open invitation to a regulator to take more powers to deal with the wolf at the door. Because I don't think you're going to stop the wolf. I think that's a past that's gone. That's going to be there and have to be dealt with. And it's a very difficult and delicate, I think, kind of issue for working out a strategy which will accommodate the realities, but try to hold back regulation to a more proportionate level, certainly than it's reached in England and Wales. So where are we in England and Wales? We've just finished a third report, which is not published yet. It's proving rather controversial, as the first one did in its own way. So I can't say much about it, but I can talk a little bit about some of the numbers behind it. It may well be the case that ABSs at some future date become important in the market. None of us can tell the future. No idea. But they haven't so far. And they've already had a little bit of a run at it, and they've had a longer run at it in Australia. So it is not obvious that these new organizations are in fact going to play a major role. I'm sure they'll find a niche and play some role in legal services provision, but it's very far from obvious that they are a major change factor. In fact, if you look at the market over the last few years, it's quite clear that the big impacts are from the credit crunch, from legal aid reductions, from new technology, which allows do-it-yourself in a number of legal areas, and so on. And all of those things are having much bigger impacts on, this is solicitors again, not necessarily advocates, on solicitors than ABSs. And indeed, the survey evidence suggests that when you ask people what's really bothering you today, ABSs are not really anywhere near the top of the list. The evidence is kind of interesting. The big city solicitors, the traditional model seems to work well for them. The evidence is the small solicitors, too, are holding their ground. Now, it is true that the traditional general high street practice is in decline, but what's happening is the emergence of lots of much more specialist boutique firms in IP or personal protection insurance or one of the other areas, medical malpractice and so on. You're finding these small specialist firms develop. Again, just three or four people often. And in terms of the numbers, the only bit of the market that really seems to have been squeezed a bit, this is in line with our Labour Party leaders' sound bites, is the middle. There's a kind of squeeze on middling firms. My own view on that, from the evidence and having done a number of interviews and looked at them, is that, in fact, it's mostly to do with management problems. That small firms don't have really difficult commercial problems to deal with. The biggest firms have sorted all that out long ago, but there have been in the market a number of middle-sized solicitors' practices, which have managed to survive so far, but in the tougher conditions are finding life difficult. And that is the bit of the market, I think, that is suffering. But it's not really the ABS which is causing that change. So, one possibility is that these structures won't take off. Let me say another point that came out of the most recent research. I mean, in general, they won't take off if the traditional model performs better. And if you believe in the traditional model, you will believe it will perform better. But one of the interesting things we found was that insurance companies seem to prefer the traditional model too, because what we were told by the underwriters, because you need professional indemnity insurance in order to be able to practice, it's a necessary requirement. Insurers said that if you look at a traditional law firm, it's something that's understood, it's fairly transparent, you could do the risk evaluations. But when you come to new and innovative business structures, and ABSs, that caused a problem on the insurance side because the risks were less transparent. Now, you might marry that up and say, well, of course, that would be a traditional critique of these alternative business structures. They're more liable to things like conflicts of interest, more likely to give problems. But you see, you've got a commercial entity out there in the market. There's a sort of self-regulation mechanism already in place in terms of the insurance. Because if it becomes more costly to get insurance for these types of forms of business organizations, that is one reason why they will be at a cost disadvantage relative to traditional firms, all other things being equal. So one thing I would suggest that you consider is whether it might be the case that if these things develop, you might not be more confident about what will happen to the traditional model when it's, quote, been market tested in this kind of way. One of the problems, again, is that if the market test is passed, And I think the evidence in England and Wales right at the moment, it's very cloudy and you can't be very definite. It's still experimental. But my own view is that the traditional models are still working quite well. And the difficulty in England and Wales now is that you've developed a disproportionate form of regulation which is focused on business structures. And how do you get back from that if you say at the end of the day those alternative business structures are not a major issue in this market and we don't need all this entity regulation? Because one of the outstanding facts of government behaviour in general and of regulatory behaviour is it has difficulty changing course. Once it's gone down a particular path, it's much more difficult to actually row back than it would be in the private sector. In the private sector, you've got a business, something's going wrong, drop it. Okay, cut your losses, go do something else. But these things tend to persist. And my own concern about the position in England and Wales is we may have got to that point, we may have invented a form of regulation which has been driven by these concerns, which turn out not to be such big concerns after all, but you're still left lumbered with the regulation at the end of the day. The phrase for it is stranded regulation. It's stranded there. It was invented for a problem which is really not nearly as big as it was made out to be. So I suppose it's the little boy that cries wolf. I know everybody here is concerned about ABSs, but is it a wolf or is it just an ordinary dog that's barking a bit loudly at the moment? Thank you.
Sure. Listening to Professor Yarrow makes clear, I think, that much of the traditional economic analysis that's applied to problems of regulation is really based on the traditional assumption that people are profit maximizers acting only in their own interests. When you have an unusual type of profession, such as the legal profession, where people acting in the profession don't always act entirely in their own interests, but have other duties, duties to the court, and sometimes have to act in a way that therefore is not necessarily in the interest of the client, that distorts the classic economic model, so that the economics 101 principles of perfect competition cease to have at least unmodified application. It's reminiscent, I think, of the statement by Alfred Marshall, the great 19th century economist, who said, all short statements about economics are wrong, except this one. The next speaker is Maura McGowan, who, if I may start with the fact that she is a member of the Irish Bar and the Northern Ireland Bar, but she also practices in both London and in Manchester, and is, of course, chairman of the Bar of England and Wales for 2013. She has extensive experience in all areas of crime, particularly murder, drugs, violence and sexual assault and child abuse, and she also appears in serious and complex fraud cases and public inquiries. She's been a Deputy High Court Judge since 2010 and a recorder since 1996, and is a former Vice Chairman of the English Bar Council's Professional Practices Committee and a long-standing member of the Law Reform Committee. She was also the Director of Education and Training for the South Eastern Circuit and a serving committee member of the Criminal Bar Association, and she's a bencher of the Middle Temple, with which, of course, the Irish Bar and the King's Inns have such a long and very close relationship. Maura McGowan.
Michael, thank you, and thank you all for inviting me here today. If my granny could see me sitting here at a table in the Jameson's distillery with two Oxford professors and a man called Michael Collins, she'd be horrified. When regulation works well, it's grand. When it doesn't, it's a disaster. And there is a balance, there is a way through. And I don't speak this afternoon to tell you to do it the way we did, but I hope to be able to persuade you this afternoon to learn from our mistakes, so that whatever mistakes you make or are made here, they're not ones that you can have already learned from. Our senior top regulator, the chair of the Legal Services Board, is reported to have said that selling books is not the same as being a barrister, but regulating booksellers is the same as regulating barristers. And that's our problem. And as Michael just said, it isn't the same. We are not people driven solely by profit. We are not people who have nothing other than our own or our clients' commercial interests. We all of us have a code, whether it's written down or not, a code which means that we have an overriding duty to the court, a duty quite often not to act in our own best economic interest, and a duty on occasions not to act in what is necessarily, either in reality or in perception, the best interests of the lay client. And so regulating us is not like regulating somebody who sells something. We reached the point that you are now facing, as you know, some years ago. And we went from a position whereby, as a comparatively small profession, we're now only 15,000, and then probably no more than 10 or 12, only about 80% of whom are in private, independent practice. We went from a position when we regulated ourselves very well, and we were acknowledged to regulate ourselves very well. We have no contact, traditionally, with clients' money. And it's not that we're necessarily more honest than anybody else, but if you can't get near the till, you tend not to be able to put your hand in it. And so we didn't have the same problems that the solicitors had. Complaints made about us by potential regulators and the government were that our systems were too complicated. Well, that was probably a fair criticism. Or that by having the procedures and practices in place that we did, they were too restrictive. They made it too difficult to be a barrister. I still don't understand that. It is as difficult to be a barrister as it is. You have to qualify, you have to practice. But the main complaint levelled against the legal profession in England and Wales was that they were absolutely useless at handling clients' complaints. And that was never fairly laid against us. That was the solicitors. They were years behind in dealing with complaints. They were never dealt with, or very rarely dealt with, quickly enough. And they were rarely dealt with satisfactorily, so far as the clients were concerned. But that was the position, and that was what hit us at the same time as it hit the solicitors. And we went through what you're going through now, and we went through it for a very, very long time. And we danced around a number of different proposals, a number of different models, as they were called. And we had Model A, and we had Model B, and we had Model B plus. And again, I've never been entirely sure why that wasn't simply Model C, but it wasn't. And we worked incredibly hard through some incredibly difficult negotiations. But we had, if you like, a ringmaster in the shape and form of Sir David Clementi, who'd been given the task by the Ministry of Justice and the government to work his way through this. And so to that extent, we had it much easier than you do, because we had an official referee, an umpire. But we did go through the incredibly difficult negotiation process that you're going through. And we reached what, as you know now, was called the B plus model. And it is an extraordinarily bizarre model. It's Byzantine. But it works, more or less. And it means that the Bar Council is its own regulator. We are the approved regulator for the profession of barristers in England and Wales. And that's not just a paper victory. That's not just language. It's a very significant fact. But we hold the position of independent regulator only so long as we delegate the entire responsibility for that regulation to the Bar Standards Board. and we must give them the responsibility and the powers and the duties to carry it out, and necessary funding, reasonable funding, to do that. And we work with them, and we work against them, and we manage. And it's not perfect, but it works, give or take. The real problem, of course, is that whilst we're running this sort of scheme, and the solicitors are running something very similar, and the legal executives and everybody else down the food chain, over the top, there has to be an overarching, an overreaching regulator, the LSB. And the LSB are our current problems. They don't just supervise, they interfere, in our opinion. Strangely enough, they wouldn't agree with that. But rather than just making sure that we behave ourselves, that the BSB behaves itself, and that we are properly regulated, they have ideas. And one of their ideas is the Legal Education and Training Review. It's a significant document. It arose because the head of the LSB said that our training and education was not fit for purpose. It took months and years, and cost no doubt a fortune, and we paid. And at the end of it, it said, well, actually, you should tighten up on this, or you should tighten up on that, or you should do this. But basically, it works. And that's the sort of micromanagement that is a problem. You, I think, can avoid that problem by working through a scheme currently that doesn't bring that extra layer in. What we have at the moment, strangely enough, is a political situation where putting all the fights about legal aid to one side for the moment, we actually have a Secretary of State for Justice who agrees that we are overregulated, that it is too expensive, that it is too much of a burden on the profession. And our Ministry of Justice has called for evidence to look ahead to a regulatory framework, or reworking the regulatory framework, to do with the regulation of the legal profession. Now, we've written a paper. Unusually for us, it's only 6 or 7 pages, and I will make sure that David Nolan has it, so that you can all see it and have access to it, because it sets out there some of the problems that we've had to deal with and some of the things that we are now looking towards to iron out those problems. And as I said at the start, you can avoid making the same problems or the same mistakes in the first place. You might as well take advantage of the fact that we've been through this process for 6 or more years, and we can now see where some things have gone wrong. The cost is high of regulation. Make no mistake about that. Ruth is right. It costs perhaps not as much as £7.5 million, but getting on for that, that's what we pay to run the BSB. On top of that, we pay to run the LSB. Nothing like so much. We're a very small part of the legal profession. We only pay about 5% of their costs. But we also pay for the Office of Legal Complaints. Again, not a lot. But it does mean that each individual is paying hundreds of pounds a year to be regulated. And if there's any way that you can look at our system and find a way of doing it more cheaply, then that is what you should be doing. You should be looking, as I've said already, to the mistakes that we've made to see if you can avoid them. The Office for Legal Complaints is actually a great success. It deals with the sort of complaints from clients about somebody being late or rude, or they didn't like me, they didn't speak to me nicely. The sort of complaints which, quite frankly, don't really strike at the core of a profession's identity, and which shouldn't really be occupying expensive staff or expensive procedures to deal with. And that's fine. This is the modern age. We do have to, I'm afraid, deal with complaints from clients along those lines. But the professional disciplinary matters, those that go to the essence of what we do and why we do it, are dealt with by the BSB. Now, I would love to go back to a point of self-regulation, but it's not going to happen. And the most that we can do is seek to lighten the burden. And as I say, we are fortunate because our Ministry of Justice, on that, if not on nothing else, agrees with us. One of the things that you should learn from what we've gone through, and it's worth looking at the first few sections of our Legal Services Act 2007, in particular Section 4, which sets out the regulatory objectives, what it is our regulators should be doing. Look at that and make sure that you don't include all of that in anything that is inflicted upon you. Because ours includes, utterly bizarrely in my view, a requirement that there is a professional, or rather a regulatory requirement upon the BSB to ensure that the profession increases the citizen's understanding of its legal rights and duties. So the government, through the Legal Services Act, has put a responsibility upon us to educate the public. Now, imagine if the body that regulated doctors included a professional requirement upon doctors that they should not simply volunteer when they wanted to run the Red Cross or the equivalent, but that they were obliged by statute to educate the public in matters of health. What on earth has that got to do with the regulators? Why should they be doing that? Simple answer is they shouldn't. So again, it's worth looking at the detail. It's worth going back over it. We have tried, and I think in large measure, succeeded to work with the Bar Standards Board. And as I'm sure is obvious, if you have somebody who actually believes in the profession that is being regulated in the way that Ruth Deitch does, then clearly that's going to make working together a good deal more worthwhile. The opposite side of that, again, is back to the beast, the elephant in the room, the Legal Services Board. I watched the chair of the Legal Services Board and the chief executive give evidence to the Justice Select Committee, which is a small group of MPs. There is one for justice, there are one for any another, number of other subjects, and periodically they will call for people to come and give evidence before them. And the chief executive officer addressed the Justice Select Committee as to how he saw the future of the provision of legal services. And he said that he looked forward to a future when legal services meant more service and less legal. Now that's the sort of attitude that you can't work with and you shouldn't have to work with. Because we are old enough not to have to be told what it is we do. We know what we do, we know why we do it. What we occasionally, and only some of us, need is to be told to do it properly. And the idea that we should be regulated by a body who see no future in the legal side of what we do, but only see us as a service industry, is deeply worrying. And so whilst the battle we've got on our hands is nothing like the one that you're facing at the moment, we are trying to push, and we are trying to push the LSB back, and in fact we're trying to push them away altogether. We propose to take back to the profession, to us, the bar, as much control over education as we will be able to grab. Why shouldn't we be the ones who say what it is academically you need to do at university and at bar school to be a barrister? Why shouldn't we be the ones who say, well, this is what you should be doing for your continuing professional development? You are a family practitioner. You need to spend 3 hours learning about this new aspect of children law. You are a commercial practitioner. You need to spend 4 hours doing arbitration. Now, why are we not fit and proper to decide the content of those courses? Answer is, we are. And we're pressing our ministry to be allowed to do that. So we want to take back to us those things that we should perfectly obviously have responsibility for. We accept that we will never get everything back, and so the BSB must continue to prosecute, to discipline, to run that side of the regulatory element of the profession. And frankly, if that was all they had to do, they'd cost us a good deal less than £500 a year each. But we want to push that back. We want to get back those things which we have an ability and a proven ability to control. And we want to get rid of the LSB. We recognise that there will be, have to be something over the top, if you like, some arch, umbrella, whatever silly word is brought in to use for the purpose, to join us to the solicitors, only insofar as to make sure that we're not cutting across one another. We can't say that one thing is the proper way to do things if they're going to say the opposite. And so there has to be some community there in what is said and proposed. But we look forward to having that layer over the top made up of the profession with some lay and significant lay membership, run by a senior judge and with input from the judiciary, there to have overall control, but not, with the greatest of respect to Professor Yarrow and to Professor Deitch, to have yet another professional regulator in charge. There are people who regulate the professions, but there are a lot of people out there who do nothing other than become professional regulators. And that's a waste of our money. It's a huge, cumbersome burden in bureaucracy terms. And for those of you who are publicly funded, first of all, you have my sympathy, but for those of you who are publicly funded, it is actually your money. It's not a cost that's passed on to the public, to the client. Whereas for those of you who are funded by your clients will pick up the extra bill. And how does that become in the public interest? And so Ruth is right. There are key ways of arguing this. The first must be that behind everything you do and say, you can justify it in the public interest. And it is clearly in the public interest that the profession is independent. And I listened to your Minister of Justice in Brussels last week talk in support of an independent judiciary. An independent judiciary only exists for as long as you have an independent profession. The independence of the profession, the diversity and the independence of the judiciary, again, are in the public interest. Keeping costs to a reasonable and sensible level is in the public interest. Having a profession that doesn't spend 50% of its time ticking boxes is in the public interest. Trying to persuade them that they don't have to get rid of everything in order to get what they want, that much of the way in which you already regulate yourselves is good, and all right, it may need to be formalised, it may need even to be put in some sort of language that makes it more acceptable to ministers rather than normal people, but hey. But those are things that can be done. And if you can get as close to a good model as we did, but at this stage learn what we have learned in the 6 years since, then that will have been a real achievement. Because, as I said before, a lot of what we have works, by no means perfectly, but practically it does. And provided we can deal with the super regulator problem, provided we can lighten the costs, provided we can take control back to ourselves of how we educate both people coming into the profession and those of us within it, then we would be personally and professionally, in England and Wales at least, a good deal happier. but those ends are in sight. And you just have to keep pushing and pushing and pushing and pushing back. And if that means going to the public and saying, look, you'll lose the independent judiciary you value if you don't have an independent profession, so be it. As I say, if your minister is prepared to espouse the benefit of an independent judiciary, then he must, it must follow, accept the need for the existence of an independent profession. There is only a couple more things I'd like to say. ABSs, well, perfectly possible for us. Very, very little take-up, and I suspect, looking into the future, at least within a reasonable time span, very little take-up. They're there if people want them. A couple of people, for example, with very specialist tax practices have chosen to do it because they can be part of a firm that gives tax advice some of the time, but an independent practitioner the rest of the time. It's designed to allow flexibility. There will be very few people, certainly practicing in England and Wales, who will want that level of flexibility, but it's there. They may not be the monsters that you fear. I'm not sure what the take-up would be here, how anybody would ever look at it. But what they have been for us is an enormously expensive add-on. We've had to pay a very large amount of money to the regulators to get to the point whereby they can approve them. And in due course, I suspect we're going to find that there are very few that require approval. Again, we've been through it. If you can learn from it, do. The one other thing that you need to look at, and this will affect or will actually have an impact on how our Ministry of Justice looks at this, is how the rest of the world sees what happens. I've already had concerns expressed to me from, in particular, American law firms, but not exclusively American law firms, that the level of regulation prevents us from being independent. Now, in reality, it probably doesn't, and that may simply be a perception. But if it is a perception, and if overseas law firms stop using English and Welsh law firms for that reason, or practitioners for that reason, then it will have a real consequence. And so whatever comes into play has to be expressed in a way that maintains the independence. We have produced huge amounts of money for the British economy. In excess of £20 billion a year is brought in by way of import because of the provision of legal services. Now, when the government fears that that's threatened, there's a reaction. And so again, in the public interest, we have to be regulated in a particular way. Avoid those problems. I wish you well. If there's anything that we can take you through just to show you the mistakes we've made, we will be more than happy to do that. I want to make it absolutely clear, I'm not for one second saying you must do what we have done. You may want to, you may not. That will ultimately be a matter for you. But if there are any mistakes we've made, any lessons we've learned along the way that simply avoid you having to go through the same problems, then I, my successor, I'm sure, would all be very happy to help in any possible way. As I say, I wish you luck.
Thank you very much, Maura. One thing that certainly comes out of Maura's very helpful description is that although it is a Byzantine structure indeed in England in terms of regulation, it nonetheless remains oversight regulation. It is regulation where the Bar Council is the regulator, albeit delegated to the Bar Standards Board, but with overarching regulation from the Legal Services Board. Now, that may be a complex model that mightn't appeal to everybody, but it does remain oversight regulation. The stark contrast with our bill is that we have direct frontline regulation by the government, and that is a distinction that we need to analyse and grapple with and consider the consequences. And I draw attention to one other point which Maura raised about training and academic training. which is a feature of the bill that may not be of a direct concern on a day-to-day basis, but it concerns the extent to which the new authority is supposed to give directions to academic institutions in terms of the content of legal training. And it raises, in my view, issues of academic freedom and consistency of those provisions with the guarantee of academic freedom in the Universities Act. And the question of academic freedom is another point which I believe to be a fundamental public interest, which we as the bar should not lose sight of either. Can I now turn to introduce Signor Aldo Bulgarelli, who is a former chairman of the Verona Bar and chair of the International Committee of the Italian National Bar. He is presently the first vice president of the CCBE, the Council of European Bars and Law Societies. He's a former secretary general of the board of directors and then president of the Verona Bar and a former secretary general of the Federation of European Bars. He's been a lawyer for over 30 years and is now a partner with NCTM, who have offices all around the world. He founded and chaired both the Culture and International Committees of the Verona Bar and was an honorary judge of the Verona Court. Signor Aldo Bulgarelli.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Michael. Good afternoon. I hope to be able to close the computer without provoking any major damages, because I have a bit of paper here. If you look into the title of today's conference, Regulation of the Independent Bar, the Future, I will deal two aspects of this. Independence of the Bar, from my side, and Regulation of the Future, MDPs and ABSs. Only some methodological approach on the costs, which were one of the major issues this afternoon. Starting with independence, I will have three documents I will speak to you about, and some considerations, and another document. And then I will deal a bit about multidisciplinary practice and alternative business structure. In this case, some considerations and some documents. At the end of 2011, the CCBE learned from the Irish delegation of concerns about a draft piece of legislation, which is the Legal Services Regulation Bill. At the end of it, of this year, 21st of December, the press of the CCB wrote a letter to the International Monetary Fund expressing these concerns. CCB was conscious, and is conscious, of the need for reforms, and bars are open to reforms. Bars are not at all against reforms. They understand society changes, and society needs some changes and reforms. But we realized that in this bill, there were some unprecedented reforms which could endanger the independence of the lawyers. Concerns about this independent regulator was not concerning the fact that it was independent, but this bill would undermine the independence of lawyers. In our opinion, it was and is, because until now, I think the version is all the same we had read in 2011, we had a clear breach of the core principle of lawyers, and above all, of independence of the legal profession. Self-regulation, in our opinion, is needed and is respected almost everywhere in Europe. Indeed, in this way, it is respected everywhere. Meaning of independent regulation, in our opinion, the logical natural consequence of the independence of the profession. It's a part, collective independence is a part of the independence of the single lawyer. A structural defense of the individual lawyer. Independence from everyone, everything, including the government pressure. The last point of this letter was that we were afraid about an erosion of the administration of justice, because this threatened to the independence of lawyers was a serious threat to the administration of justice, and then to the interest, to public interest, to which Mora a lot spoke before. A second letter on the beginning of January of 2012 was written by the new president of the CCBE, Marcella Prumbauer, to the Irish government, recalling some international instruments who deal with the independence of lawyers, independence of the bar. We are not a religion, but we also have a sort of Bible, which is all these international instruments. I don't, of course, read them, but just to recall to you, at level of United Nations, at level of Council of Europe, at level of jurisprudence of the European Court of Justice and European Court of Human Rights, at level of Charter of Fundamental Principles of European Union, and also at level of our core principles of our profession. After having reminded these fundamental international instruments, the president of CB in the moment, Marcella Prumbauer, observed that it contained provisions involving an encroachment on the independence of the legal profession in Ireland, which have been not adopted in any other European Union jurisdiction. We, of course, consider that the United Kingdom is something similar, but indeed a complete changing like it was introduced now, proposed in Irish, in Ireland, was rejected in the United Kingdom on the grounds that continued existence of independent legal professions was incompatible with such a degree of governmental control. Our concerns, if you look at into the bill, is not only the government nomination of 11 members, but the fact that the government has the power to remove any of these at any moment without a real justification, if not only the consideration that it's needed for the efficient works of the authority, but only the government in this phase decides when it is the case to remove one of these members. We also observed that the control by the government was full, including training, entry and discipline of lawyers. We were happy to receive an answer by International Monetary Fund. The answer of February 2012, told us that International Monetary Fund, which you know it's one of the Troika, one of the three organs of the Troika, International Monetary Fund, European Commission, and the European Central Bank. They told us, we take very seriously the important issues you have raised, particularly issues concerning the independence of the profession. And they also say, important, very important, the rule of law, it's a key ingredient in fostering a positive business and investment climate. So it's very important also for the growth. And it also recognizes the maintenance of rule of law is underpinned by strong and independent institution, including, and I follow what Maura said before, judiciary and the legal profession. And they wrote that, of course, they understand that the Legal Services Regulation Bill goes to institute a new independent regulator, which is included in the requests that the International Monetary Fund made to Ireland for lending money, but there is no intention on the part of the International Monetary Fund that independence of the legal profession be undermined by any of the measures discussed in the program documents. They also told us that in their understanding, a similar position had been maintained by the European Commission. And further, they noticed that the Irish authorities have publicly stated that support the principal independence of legal profession. Indeed, they sent to us a copy of a letter of your government that, of course, reaffirmed the necessity of reform, but says they were ready to introduce amendments, and they called them constructive amendments. So we hope that these amendments are introduced and discussed, above all, with you, which is absolutely important for us. This, as far as concerns independence, but I told you before that there's another document which is important in my opinion, nothing to do with the European Union. We go over the Atlantic Ocean into the country of of Canada. The Court of Appeal of British Columbia recently, for April 2013, issued a very, very interesting decision stating in clear letters that the independence of the bar is fundamental on, to a legal principle. It's a fundamental, sorry, for the justice. I read exactly the conclusion, which is, just a minute, yes. Independence of the bar is a principle of fundamental justice. This decision was rendered in a case about anti-money laundering case. You're maybe interested in the fact that the Court of Appeal of British Columbia obtained to suspend the application of this legislation to Canadian lawyers because it was against the fair administration of justice and violating some principles of European, of lawyers. As far as concerns alternative business structures, because we deal with the multidisciplinary practice, but at the end, what is very, very important is the very brand new alternative business structures introduced in UK. The CCB has a clear position about this. Since 1999, we expressed our position, which is that we raise concerns about the impact of such structures on the core values of the profession. Which are these core values? Independence, above all, but also the avoidance of conflict of interest and respect the client's confidentiality. This position of 1999 were reiterated by the CCB in 2005, 2006, 2009, and this is interesting because it was an answer responding to a questionnaire sent by SRA and Legal Services Board about in a phase of consultation before issuing Legal Service Act. We, of course, consider usually pros and cons of ABSs, including economic consideration, which was dealt with by Professor Iero before. But our position remained consistent over the years, pointing out the threats that such business structures entail. Which is the problem? The problem is non-lawyers. Of course, the danger is higher if the non-lawyers are non-professional, non-regulated professionals, because non-lawyers are not per se bound by the same duties as lawyers. And this difference of duties can create a very dangerous conflict inside the ABS, to the detriment of clients, above all. Remember what we did, we committed, as was recalled before, in 2012 to Professor Iero, an independent study, which is available on our website if you're interested in it. In this study, it's very, very clear there are some keywords, in my opinion, which are, above all, cautious analysis and careful consideration. You cannot say that ABSs are good or bad in a general way. You have to verify, please, Professor Iero, correct me if I'm wrong, you have to verify case by case and verify in the certain environment ABS works or not. You have to need specific detail of the factual context. Independence, conflicts of interest, and ethics could be endangered by this. I invite you, I don't do it, but you can do that, pages 124, 211, to 213. In all these parts of the study of the Professor Iero, it's absolutely clear that a careful consideration is needed before introducing an ABS. It's not automatic, absolutely. According to our current state of information, many jurisdictions in Europe still prohibit alternative business structure. The vast majority of European jurisdictions do not allow them. Some of them allow them, but always with a very clear limit. Non-lawyers have to be the minority. In Italy, they have to be not more than one-third. In other countries, not more than 49%, but never, never the majority. Another interesting thing is this. That the Establishment Directive of 98 You all know the establishment of the Act 98 is very, very important for the free circulation of lawyers, permit member states to oppose the opening of certain legal business structures when, where the fundamental rules governing that grouping, the home member state, are incompatible with fundamental rules laid down by law, regulation, or administrative action in the host member state. In this case, the latter rules shall prevail insofar as compliance therewith is justified by the public interest in protecting client and third parties. Thanks to this provision, in France, in 2012, a clear resolution was issued by the Conseil National des Barreaux against the admission of new ABSs, English ABSs in France, as far as majority of law lawyers are included in this. The date is 15-16 June, and the words they use are very, very strong because they say that these types of ABSs, English ABSs, if the majority of them are non-lawyers, they are of such a nature to endanger the warranties by the French deontological rules and against the public interest. So they're not allowed at all in France. So if we think that these new forms of business are introduced to increase the possibility of the lawyers to compete with others, just reflect on this consideration. Abroad, it will never be possible to go abroad to France, for example, if the majority of non-lawyers in ABS. So it's a counterproductive effect of introducing such structures. So going on with some other examples, the Wouters case. Wouters case is very important because in this case, the European Court of Justice admitted that Dutch rules prohibiting multidisciplinary partnership were possible because it was reasonable for the Netherlands rules to impose binding measures despite the facts entailed which are restrictive of the competition. In that case, there was legal accountants who had rules against, different from the rules of lawyers, and so in that case, a multidisciplinary practice was not allowed. The European Court of Justice says this. This is a very important decision, in my opinion, because in this case, you also have the possibility to solve the problem which was put before by the precedent speakers, the relationship between lawyers and competition. We are book readers, we are not book sellers, as going to say before. Of course, Mora, you are perfectly right, but the solution is the following. The European Court of Justice says lawyers are subject to European rules about competition, but not unlimited. The clear limit is the administration of justice in public interest. In the Dutch case, it works, and maybe in your case it will be work, if the rule will be excessive and against the administration of justice, against the interest of clients, in this case it will be against the European rules. Also, the service directives of 2006 say something about this. So, anyway, this is our position. And as far as concerns the coasts, we are really not so experienced like United Kingdom is, because they have introduced this, but in an early stage. So our idea is always, coming back to what Professor Yarrow wrote, that we have, before analyzing this coast, we have to analyze this coast before introducing the law. We cannot say it is not expensive if not verified correctly by a study, an independent study commissioned by the government, which of course should have to consult the Bar Council, the Law Society, the professionals involved, and committee, and to have an independent study about the cost. Because maybe what we heard about until now, cost could be really, really high, and not at all in the public interest. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much indeed, Aldo, and I think it's clear from his contribution that this is not a problem which is unique to this jurisdiction, or indeed just to the English-speaking islands in which we live, but a problem throughout Europe and indeed across the world, because not only have the CCPE written to the Taoiseach and the Minister for Justice in relation to our bill, but so also has the American Bar Association, the International Bar Association, and the American Academy of Trial Lawyers, among others, and have written to also the US ambassador the Irish ambassador in Washington. So this is a worldwide problem, and it does raise very significant issues. The last speaker, after which I hope we will have some time for some questions and answers, although we are going to try to plan to finish by 5 o'clock, is David Nolan. I'm going to resist the temptation to get revenge for all the scurrilous things he said about me from time to time in the past by simply reminding you that he is chairman of the Bar Council of Ireland. Thank you.
Brothers and sisters, friends, it is a singular honour for me to stand before you as your chairman at this crucial time in our existence. My predecessor, Paul O'Higgins, worked tirelessly on this issue when it came before us in a most unusual way. And I don't want to go through the whole history of how that occurred, but suffice to say that unlike Maura's experience, this piece of legislation or proposed legislation did not find its way into life through consultation or dialogue. We have, however, waited 2 years now since it was first published, and you have probably heard the various radio programmes and television programmes and commentators saying about the influence that vested interests have had in delaying this. Well, we're one of those vested interests, and part of me would like to accept that wonderful compliment about how influential we have been, and part of me has to accept the reality. We've had no influence whatsoever. The delay has not been of our making, and the delay has not been of our doing. The reality is that this is one of the most complex pieces of legislation which has been formulated, and the fact that it was born in the way it was born, already made in many respects, can only show how difficult it has been. So be it. When it came out first, we have been criticised by others because we raised concerns. And we use the word raised concerns because we had concerns. Legitimate concerns, as it turned out to be, particularly on the issue of independence. To be fair to the Minister, he said that he wanted to make some amendments, and he has made some amendments. Not, however, as you've already heard from the stellar group that have been here today, enough amendments, but he has made some amendments. We, the Bar, us, brothers and sisters, we are in favour of independent regulation. I'm saying it now, I'm saying it loud, I'm saying it clear. I've had to go around, as have all the other members of the Bar Council, who have met many, many other cabinet ministers and TDs and public representatives, and we've had to make that point. We made it in today's Independent. We've made it on television. We've made it on radio. In fact, we've been saying it since this bill came into existence, and yet some people don't still want to accept that big step forward. We are in favour of independent regulation. We accept that in the 21st century, even though our own regulation, self-regulation, has worked wonderfully, we accept that that is not what the general public now want to live with. So be it. Now is the time, and it has been for the last 2 years, that dialogue should take place between ourselves and the Minister, and the Law Society and the Minister. And in that regard, I'm particularly honoured and would like to welcome the present President of the Law Society, John Shaw, together with his predecessor, James McCourt, and the Director of the Law Society, Ken Murphy, who have stood beside us throughout all of the various discussions, informal and formal. There have some who have said that the Law Society are not our friends. I can say to you, the Law Society are our best friends, and we should be very grateful that we have them. Why? Because we support solicitors. We support small and medium-sized solicitors' firms throughout
the country. We also support large law firms as well. We act for those who want our services. And the Law Society knows that. And now government knows it, because we've said it again and again. What, however, we are concerned with is, and one of the reasons we thought it would be useful for you to hear Professor Yarrow, hear Baroness Deitch, hear Maura McGowan, is the cost of that regulation. We have done our regulatory impact assessment. We've done it by a recognised professional outside body. They have come up with figures which are frightening. They have come up with assessments which suggest that the cost of independent regulation is going to be between 1,500 and 2,000 euro per barrister. If only it was just £500. We could nearly live with that. But the reality is it's going to be well in excess of that. Why? Because there are two distinct aspects to the costs. There's the costs of the regulatory side, which will, as we heard from Professor Yarrow and from Baroness Deitch, always being a bureaucratic organisation, will grow and grow and grow. And on the other hand, there's the cost of the independent disciplinary structures, of which we have nothing to fear whatsoever. But that cost will be translated from a voluntary cost as it is now, where the cost per barrister, as I say, is 40 euro approximately, even though it is the majority of lay people who man those disciplinary structures. That cost is now going to be borne by us. And in those two sides, the first being the regulatory cost, the proposal is 10%, 10%, Law Society, Bar Council, and then on the basis of the number of professionals there are within the branches of each profession. There are 2,400 barristers. There are approximately 10,000 solicitors. So we're already going to be in for a much larger chunk than we ever were before. On the other side, it's going to be on the disciplinary side, it's going to be 10%, 10%, and on the principle of the polluter pays. The reality is last year we had between 40 and 50 complaints dealt with by our disciplinary tribunals. 40 or 50. Compared to the Law Society, because it's a far more complex business that the solicitors are involved in, dealing with client funds, etc., it was many, many more times than that. So we are going to be burdened either way with a disproportional element of the cost of this expensive regulatory structure. We've called for an RIA. We called for it 2 years and 2 months ago. We still, to this day, do not have an RIA. We still, to this day, do not have the amendments dealing with so many other aspects. There have been amendments in relation to some parts of the bill. Let's be absolutely honest. Those amendments were rushed through the Justice Committee, the Joint Oireachtas Justice Committee, in over between 2 hours and 3 hours. That's how much it took. No amendments put forward by the opposition parties were accepted by the Minister, and the matter was simply pushed through. Now we're getting to the meat and two veg of this piece of legislation. Now we're getting to the issues of ABSs, and the issues of the cost structures of the regulatory authorities. This is where we need dialogue. This is where we have been making a case to the ministers, to government. And I've met, as have David Barnival, Colm O'Hushing, and other members of the Bar Council, Tony McGillicuddy, we have met with over 8 members of cabinet. Even though I have asked and asked and asked, informally, formally, and otherwise, I have yet to meet the minister on the record to discuss these matters. Of course, I've met him informally, and I have to say I get on with him informally. But I want to talk formally to him about these amendments before they are simply pushed through the Joint Oireachtas Committee. I want to ask him, would he not consider, in relation to, for example, ABSs, allow the regulator carry out the appropriate studies that Maura has talked about, that Aldo has talked about, to make sure that these structures, these alternative business structures, multidisciplinary practices, are appropriate for a country the size of Ireland. We are 4 million people. We're smaller than Greater Manchester. Why do we have to create for ourselves a third force in legal services? Because that's what it is. There is an ideological conflict between intense direct regulation of the barristers and solicitors profession on one hand, and the creation of a third force with no regulation, or practically no regulation. Why? Because this piece of legislation doesn't contain any amendments or any proposals in relation to how those other structures, whether it be multidisciplinary practices or ABSs, how they will be controlled. Why? Because, quite frankly, it is such a complex thing to do that if it was put into this legislation, it would go to another 150 pages, and nobody would understand it then. So I don't understand why, when we've all accepted the benefits and the proposal in relation to independent regulation, why we also have to have thrown in there, without any study, the burden of an alternative business structures. Some have said to me, this will really be a great benefit to the young bar. It would be of no benefit to the young bar. This will be benefit to big business. This will benefit banks. This will benefit very large, big corporate entities. In fact, one government minister went so far. She said, well, who's going to regulate it? I said, you're absolutely right, Minister. She said, but isn't that only going to benefit vested interests in the form of large finance houses? You're absolutely right, Minister. This is the type of dialogue that we need to have about this crucial change to the legal landscape. And if we don't have this type of debate, a big mistake is going to be made, and we are going to live with that down the road. It would be a terrible shame that when, for example, costs have been coming right down, as we all know, to our detriment, and the parts of the bill in relation to costs themselves, we accept, in fact, most of those are our recommendations, it would be a terrible tragedy that all that good work in relation to the reduction of costs would be lost by, without considering it, the introduction of these alternative business structures, which tend to become overburdensome, bureaucratic themselves, and to cost more for the client. One of the reasons why the bar is such an attractive place for people to come to work is we are independent. Alternative business structures, MDPs, are not independent. And if, as we know, the minister believes in the concept of an independent judiciary, why on earth are we creating a third force which has nothing to do with independence? I thought it was interesting that Maura mentioned that one of the few ABSs that has taken off is in relation to tax law. We have actually said that that's one of the problems with this. You're going to restrict competition. Experts in the area of probate, experts in the area of tax, experts in the area of planning may decide to get together. And instead of having 20, 40, 60 independent advocates in this area, you'll have 3, 6, or 9. That's not in the public interest. Because the one thing that we must take away from today is that whatever change is happening, and we accept change, and we accept the fact that there will be an independent regulation, but only, only in the public interest. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, David. We have some time for some questions, and we have a roving microphone which Inga has. So if you want to contribute, please state your name and the date of your call. David, do you want to sit up there? Any questions? There's a person at the very back. I can't quite see with the lights, I'm afraid.
Sorry, this is not so much a question as a request. According to my calculations, if the Barristers Tribunal as it presently operates is costing each of us €40 per annum, I make that a total cost of 96,000. I haven't yet worked out the multiplier on the alternative, which costs between 1,500 and 2,000. And I just wonder if you could email to all of us within the next few days a breakdown of the 96,000 and how it's arrived at, and also a breakdown of the figure of between 1,500 and 2,000 and how it's arrived at. I feel I'd like to be in a position to make an informed decision, and I don't feel that I am on the basis of figures that are just thrown out. I realise that this meeting was called as a matter of urgency, but I think I would like to see some hard and fast specific figures rather than just general statements, if that's possible.
just to you.
That's no problem. In fact, we've, I think, put up on our website a number of the different papers that we have already done, including the regulatory impact assessment. So that's actually up on the website. But you're asking me for a specific thing, and certainly we'll give it to you. No problem.
Yes.
Micro. We can. You understand?
No problem.
Okay. Could I bring more in on that too?
Just so that you get some picture of it, the direct cost to us of the Bar Standards Board 2013 is 4.3 million. Now, the figure Ruth gave was a lot higher than that. Hers worked out at about 7.5 million. That's because they are in the same building as us, and so we split, if you like, the costs of the building and staff and HR and IT and photocopying paper and all that sort of nonsense. So, as I say, I'm not convinced that Ruth's figure of 7.5 million is necessarily right. I think that may be a slight overestimate, but it will be in the order of £500 per barrister. That includes the non-independent, the self-employed, sorry, the employed who are in government legal service or private practice within firms. But that's genuinely, I think, probably an accurate figure, give or take, for us.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Eugenie Houston, Trinity 2008. First of all, I want to thank all the speakers for really a fabulous conference. I'm very grateful. I'm sure others feel the same, that you've come to help us in the way that you have this afternoon. I have three brief questions to put out to the panel. The first is for David Nolan. I think my colleague has partly asked the question. It's in relation to the numbers behind the cost analysis. And until David answered just a few minutes ago, I have to say, as a member of the Law Library, I had no idea that that information was on our website, so I'm very glad to hear that. But I'd like to make a further suggestion, David, and it's this, that there seems to be an impasse in the discussions with Minister Shatter on this very important issue of costs. So I'm just wondering if, in fact, you, as Chairman of the Bar Council, should simply publish in the media the entire content of that report, and then I think that would provide the impetus for the Minister to respond in detail to the specific detail. I can't really see how he could avoid doing that. And my second question is for the Chairman of the Bar Council of England and Wales, Maura McGowan. Very, very interested to hear what you had to say, and I'm just wondering if it's possible if you could comment a little bit on the Bar Council's recent Barco initiative, which, speaking at a personal level, I would be delighted if we had here. And my third question is to, I think probably to David Nolan. It relates to a situation that exists in Ireland where we have a situation where we have non-lawyers giving legal advice. It's not uncommon, and certainly it's been my experience and that of other colleagues in employment law, to be faced with a non-lawyer in a situation where you might be dealing with an issue that could end up in the High Court, and that raises a lot of quite complex ethical issues. It's far from ideal, but those people are not regulated, and I'm just wondering if the Bar Council has a view on that, and also the question of barristers who are no longer members of the Law Library, to whom are they accountable? Thank you very much.
Perhaps I ask Maura to answer first.
Barco, in one sense it's perfectly simple, in another it's really quite complicated because lawyers designed it. It was set up for two reasons. First of all, we have introduced direct access. It's limited but growing. Secondly, we have had in position for quite a long time the ability of overseas law firms to instruct English and Welsh barristers directly. So that meant that we had to learn how to deal with client money. And so we, as you know, are based on a chambers model. We have clerks. They have never had to deal with client money. They don't know how to deal with it, particularly in a time of money laundering and things of that sort. So Barco is effectively an escrow account. You join it. You can either join it for once for one case, or you can join it forever, as it were. The client signs up to it as well. The client pays whatever money is designed to be paid, so either your fees, and they can be provisional, so he can pay a lot more than the first piece of work is going to cost, but then you have the security of knowing that all the money is being held. And in certain circumstances, he can also hold settlement monies. The money goes into the account, it's held independently. You can't get it out until the client signs off to say the work's finished. He can't get it out until you say, I haven't done the work or I didn't do it properly, so he can have the money back. And it's designed to remove all those problems that solicitors have had to face over the years. It's insured, it includes its own money laundering, checks and security provisions, although you do actually still have to do the know your client thing, so you have to see a passport or whatever at the start. It's capped at £250 per case, but in fact it costs, I think it's 2%. So it's designed not to be expensive. Obviously, the greater the case, the greater the benefit. It's there as a safeguard for us, really, because the days of not being able to sue for your fees are all well and good when you don't really need to earn that money to live on, but given that most of us do, you did need, or you do need to be able to sue for your fees. So that's the reason we've done it. There's a lot of information on our website, but if anybody wants to email me directly about it, I can give you chapter and verse as is necessary.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you, Maura. Just in relation to the two matters that you raised, Eugenie, with myself, the first one about publishing information in regard to ourselves and the Minister, I prefer jaw-jaw than wah-wah. And so to that extent, I'd prefer not to have rows. I want to try and make sure that this legislation works because it's going to set the landscape for the next 100 years. So I want to work with the Minister, as we've said all the way along, in relation to the amendments, and so I don't want to have a fight, I want to have a negotiation. In relation to the issue of non-lawyers in employment law, I think that's a very interesting matter and one which probably relevant for another conference at another time, because there are certain proposals before government to changing the EAT and in fact abolishing the EAT. So that could well be a feature which lawyers are going to encounter far more frequently in the future. In regard to membership of the law library, that really is a matter for the King's Inns. When, since 1986, since barristers take their call, they give an undertaking to the benchers or the Chief Justice. Fergal Fulby, you would tell me which, I'm never too sure. The benchers, that they will practice as members of the law library only. So that's an undertaking. A breach of an undertaking is a matter for the King's Inns. It's not a matter for the law library. If members have left the law library, they've left the law library. That's, in many ways, certainly is the view of some people, that the law library has no further function thereafter. So I hope that answers the queries raised.
Killian.
Yeah, thank you. Just in terms of the contribution of our distinguished speakers from England, I just wonder if the chairperson, perhaps particularly of the Bar Council, if she might accept that the chamber system limits quite a lot about the comparison between you can make between the Irish bar and the English bar. And in two respects, I suggest. Firstly, in terms of regulation and control, it seems to me that Chambers acts as an immediate peer group and offers a control there that isn't at the Irish bar. And secondly, in terms of economies and achieving economies of scale, that Chambers allows barristers to achieve those economies of scale that the sole trader cannot achieve?
Well, I think it's right that most sets of chambers are, if you like, a small group of people. So there is an element of peer pressure. But I wouldn't be saying that to your minister, because that makes it sound as though you need more regulation than us rather than less. Yes, in terms of cost, obviously we band together and share expenses, but you will share expenses, as it were, through the library. Our expenses include running buildings and having staff, and I'm not sure actually that you wouldn't find that what we pay, even in reasonably priced sets of chambers, isn't more expensive than what you pay to the library. I don't know how much you pay to the library, I'll make it clear, but I suspect actually that it, on a day-to-day basis, it may be cheaper to be a barrister in the law library here than it is to be in chambers in London.
I think that's right, Maura, and we have to realise that one of the reasons why the library system has worked so well is that we act as a co-op. We are one big cooperative. I mean, these buildings that we have here, the Shandy rooms, the Leahy rooms, open for all practitioners. The law library itself and the facilities around the country are all accessible to every member of the library at simply the membership fee, which is a subsidised fee because senior counsel pay more than their numbers would dictate. In fact, we did a study on that as well, and we were quite surprised. So the senior members of the profession, the more successful the members of the profession, are subsidising the junior members of the profession. That exists not only in terms of direct matters, but also geographically as well. So there's an awful lot of benefits to the combined sharing of facilities. We also have access to incredible databases. We have LexisNexis, et cetera, all available without any extra cost to members. So in fact, we think that the 2,400 members of the Law Library give incredible economies of scale, and that's why we think it's a very, very useful method of doing your business. So I think that perhaps is the way to look at it.
Dermot Manning, 1992. I have two questions, well, same question, but I want to ask it to Maura and to David. It's about the collecting of this money. The collecting of the money in England. I know in Ireland we pay a fee to, as David has said, to the law library, those of us that practice in the library. In Britain it's a chamber system. I mean, are you charging each individual barrister a certain amount per annum for regulation? And if so, how are you getting on with collecting that money in? And is there a large measure of people who don't pay it, and what do you do in those circumstances? And David, in those barristers that now are still practicing as barristers but not as members of the law library, how would it be intended that they should pay their fair share of the money for regulation, or will it just be charged to those who are still practicing in the law library, given that we're much easier to charge because we're physically here?
So far as we're concerned at the moment, there may be change in the future, but at the moment we charge people banded by the length of time in practice. So I think under 2 years call you pay nothing, under seven you pay so much, between seven and whatever it is, and then if you're in silk or senior counsel you pay more. That charge is made up of the cost of regulation and the cost of running the bar council, and that is compulsory in order to get a practicing certificate. So we do have a few defaulters, but very, very few, because at one stage it was simply a disciplinary offence to practice in England without a practicing certificate. It's now a criminal offence. And that's one way we've dealt with the unregulated and the people who held themselves out as barristers, to go back to the earlier question. So basically, the money is compulsory. You pay up or you don't practice.
And there's the death penalty as well.
Well, Dermot, you're right. As the bill is presently drafted, there is a charge on the Bar Council. And in fact, I can be arrested in the event of it not being charged. So if you want to get rid of me quickly, implement the legislation and then don't pay the bill. It's going to be a real trouble. We don't know what's going to happen to those barristers who are not members of the Law Library, because the charge is applied to the Bar Council and it will have to be collected by the Bar Council. And if people decide to operate outside the structure of the Law Library or Bar Council, at the moment the proposed legislation does not cover that scenario. So we'll end up presumably paying for them.
I suspect if your ministry is anything like ours, it'll be compulsory to practice that you are a member of the Bar Council. Hmm. And that's the way it'll be done.
Interesting.
Is there somebody here?
Sorry, Gerard Grork, 2000. Just a question, sorry about the lights. I'll come forward so you can see me. For a question from Maura McGowan in relation to criminal legal aid, I know it's not exactly on point, but I believe there's something of a crisis happening in England and Wales with regard to legal aid, with threats of strike action and so on and so forth. Is there anything that the Irish Bar can learn from the Bar of England and Wales in relation to that point in circumstances where there's a reasonably good chance we'll be facing a similar situation within a few years' time?
Go into commercial practice. There are no lessons to be learned because our ministry is saying we have to save X, we cannot close any more courts, we cannot close any more prisons, therefore the only other place to find that money is council's fees. And they are a monopoly, they hold the checkbook, they are in a very, very powerful position. And we argue with them, and as you say, all sorts of things are being threatened. But I'm not sure there's a lesson to be learned if any government that pays the vast majority of legal aid fees in criminal work chose to do what our government has chosen to do, you'd be faced with the same problem.
There's a hand here, I thought.
Hi, Rithika Moore, called in 2006. First of all, thank you very much. It's been very interesting seminar. It's really a question for Maura in respect of, are there lessons to be learned for us in Ireland where there would appear from the public an enormous backlash against lawyers generally? How have you gone about trying to change that with the public? And the second question, the use of the word consumer, it's also stated in our bill, and I have concerns that in fact, you know, it's the wrong word to use, as you could use a parallel with the medical profession and say patients are consumers as well. And are there lessons to be learned for us here before it becomes law? Thank you.
Well, as to the word consumer, I agree. It's a ridiculous word because I've never known whether the client sitting in the dock is the consumer, or the jury listening to what you're saying is the consumer, or the judge, or the solicitor that sent you the case, or the public at large. So I've never understood the word consumer in these circumstances. It seems to me to demonstrate a failing to understand some of the core principles of why we do things, but a very fundamental failing to understand what it is we actually do. As far as public sympathy is concerned, well, the reality is that somebody once described us as undertakers to the living, and there is very little public sympathy because most of the public think they're good and they don't need lawyers, and that the bad people who do need lawyers don't deserve them anyway. So it's tricky. The family practitioners in England and Wales were being absolutely savagely cut until a case called Baby P, a case of a child called Peter Connolly, hit the press because the social services had missed signs of abuse, physical abuse on a small child who was eventually killed by mother and father and other friend, I think, some combination of individuals anyway. And suddenly the public became very interested in that case, and as a consequence there was a huge wave of public support for lawyers and social workers and doctors who practiced in that field. And that actually brought a lot of family practitioners back from the edge. Now, I don't know how you deal with a market, if that's the right word, that is dependent upon that sort of tragedy to make people realize that they need lawyers. If you work in the criminal field in England and Wales and in the field of immigration or administration, you have no public sympathy. And it doesn't really matter whether you point to a miscarriage of justice, some of the more notorious ones in our country being based on events arising this side of the water. It doesn't matter. The public don't have a great deal of sympathy. And so we push and we push and we push at educating them. And we've got some way. I mean, there are a clump of people out there who suddenly realise that whilst they may never be arrested for anything, their student or young son in his 20s or his teens might just find himself be on the wrong side of a pub fight one night or something of that sort, and they might need a lawyer. But I'm afraid there's a great deal of public education yet to be done, and I don't know how you create amongst the public an attitude of sympathy, because the general public do not believe that they will ever need, certainly not a criminal lawyer.
Our speakers have flights to catch, so I'm going to bring this conference to a close. I just want to say that the fact that the bar, and the truth that the bar is prepared to embrace change, is something that one can see by looking back to as far back as the Competition Authority report and the bar's response to that, and the changes that we willingly embraced, indeed had suggested even a number of those changes. We are willing to embrace good things that will come out of an informed discussion, like the sort of discussion that happened in England and Wales, where there is consultation, where there is discussion papers, white papers, regulatory impact assessments, which will lead to informed decision making. But when such a radical proposal as contained in this bill is produced without that type of consultation, then from a public interest perspective, that is indeed alarming, and it is something that we need to engage with the Minister, and which David Nolan and the Bar Council are attempting to engage, and we must support them in that. I would like on your behalf, if I may, to thank our distinguished panel of speakers for coming today, for giving of their time so freely, and for creating such an interesting and fascinating and entertaining conference. And we might just show them our appreciation in the usual way.